I will speak about complex pathology. In many cases, often in the medicine, complex pathology requires complex decisions. Not easy to be done. And we are going to speak especially about aortic pathology involving the ascending aorta and the aortic arch. So my disclosures, in fact, the biggest disclosure that I have that everything that I'm showing is off-label. So speaking about aortic arch and ascending aorta, in which cases everything is straightforward? The cases with congenital aortic syndromes like Marfan, Eller, Danlos, positive patients with pathology of the ascending aorta, both aneurysm and dissection, definitely they require classical surgical treatment. What about the zones? These zones are the possible landing zones in the context of endovascular intervention. So the zone to landing, it's after the subclavian artery. It's relatively easy to be manipulated with thoracic aortic stent graft implantation. But it's not the case with the saccular arch aneurysm involving the brachiocephalic vessels. And it's even more complex in patients after surgical treatment with residual or re-dissection, aortic dissection. And in this case, it's even the ascending aorta is involved, not just the zone zero. About extending the TAVR to zone two, I mentioned this is the zone around the left subclavian artery. It's not so difficult, so it can be done with crossover bypass from the carotid artery to the subclavian artery, or with a branch graft, or with a simple chimney from the subclavian artery to the aortic arch. Or in many cases, we can cover the left subclavian artery without any fear regarding ischemic syndrome, because in most of the cases, the steel syndrome from the right vertebral through the left vertebral can give enough supply to the left arm. So this is the simple case. The most difficult is when the aneurysm or the dissection, the primary entry of the dissection, is involving the arch itself. So zone one, and even worse, zone zero. So zone zero is before the brachiocephalic trunk. This is the biggest challenge of everything. There are several small trials, like this one feasibility trial with a branched stent grafts, but still we don't have enough data, and there is no clear indication about the utilization of the branch graft. What is the challenge? The main challenge in this situation is the involvement of the supraaortic branches, so the brachiocephalic vessels that are, of course, very, very much important. And in most of these patients, we reach angulated morphology. And more than obvious, the proximity of the aortic valve to the zone zero can interfere with a possible landing zone for stent graft implantation. How is possible to avoid this situation? One of the procedures that can avoid this situation with additional stent graft on elephant trunk implantation is the so-called total debranching. It's in fact, it's a bypass from the ascending aorta to the brachiocephalic vessels. The problem is that the extracorporeal perfusion is not avoided. So we need the heart and lung machine, and in most of the cases, we need sternotomy. So it's a real operation. Open versus hybrid versus endovascular intervention. It's quite difficult to make a real comparison because in most of the cases there are some small series, in fact, that are not standardized. There is no real randomized trial comparing all the three options. In most of the cases, of course, the mortality is significant. It's reaching even 20%, even in very skillful surgical teams. The other obstacle is a relatively high stroke rate. So this is the statistics, open versus high versus endovascular intervention. You see here death rate and cerebrovascular events. It's not, definitely it's not zero. It's even more complex in the so-called patients require redo operations because of disease advancement, aneurysm or dissection. In this situation, recurrent disease is requiring redo operation. The redo operation risk is definitely almost two times higher. The mortality risk and stroke risk is almost two times higher. No speaking about sepsis, renal failure, and all the rest. So you see the different kind of interventions like ascending hemiarch and even worse in total arch replacement. Fenestrated grafts were proposed as a possible solution. The problem is that the fenestrated grafts are custom-made. So every fenestrated graft has to be custom-made following the particular anatomical features of the particular patient. So in an acute situation, of course, it's not possible to be performed because we don't have the exact fenestrated graft for the exact patient on the shelf. So this is a cadaver reconstruction about the zones. You see, the zone zero is even more complicated, and we have the brachiocephalic vessels above. Let's speak about chimneys. Chimneys is also option. Chimney or snorkel is allowing, parallel to the aortic stent graft, to put stent grafts into the brachiocephalic vessels, both left common carotid, left subclavian, and also the brachiocephalic trunk. The problem is that the parallel grafts, parallel to the to the aortic graft, can cause some invagination and gut, like a leakage place of the early or late endoleak. This is attempt for comparison. So this meta-analysis compared, in fact, for redo operation of such a complex pathology, and they compared totally open surgical, hybrid, and chimney. And Moulakakis and Mangialardi, they showed a relatively acceptable result, but still with a relatively high perioperative comorbidity and mortality. I mentioned already that the Achilles heel of the chimney technique is, in fact, the lack of sealing. In fact, with the chimneys, we are trying to provide proximal landing sealing zone in order to have a seal of the flow regarding the dissection false lumen or the aneurysm itself. And like stated here, the chimneys don't provide the perfect landing zone because of this invagination. So the stent graft itself, the aortic stent graft, has to be invaginated and to accommodate the chimneys in order to have a better sealing zone. And in this cartoon, it's very well shown that putting chimneys, one or two, parallel to the aortic graft, we need more diameter of the graft because we need more circumference. We need such a bigger circumference that can invaginate enough in order to accommodate the parallel chimneys without causing endoleak. And in fact, this is the problem. So these are the obstacles, these are the pitfalls, but nevertheless, in some cases, we have to to do complex cases in order to pay, to save the patient's life. There's some tips and tricks to avoid endoleak in chimney parallel grafts. This is the oversizing of both chimneys and aortic graft, and also kissing balloon, putting additional coils and so on. So there are some tricks to overcome this this situation. This is our during the years experience with aortic intervention. There are more than 420 aortic interventions up to date. So these are our 12 patients in a table treated with additional uncovered or covered chimney technique stents. And I will show you several. We had one patient only who died, one mortality case, who was with uncontrollable aortic dissection with imminent rupture. And unfortunately, during the, in fact, the early phase of the intervention, he ruptured and he died. So, redo arch intervention, I mentioned already that the mortality rate can reach, it's not very rare. So, even not 5, up to 10% of the patients require, after the surgical aortic, proximal aorta intervention, they require reduced surgery because of the residual aortic dissection. So, several clinical cases based on our experience. The first one is a 57-year-old male who was operated approximately 1 year and a half before the admission. He was operated in another town. And he had severe dizziness and chest pain. And because of that, he was investigated with a CT angio. And it resulted that he had, unfortunately, type A aortic residual dissection. So you see here, this is the entry point. This, the big one is the false lumen. The small one is the true lumen. Unfortunately, this entry point, just before the brachiocephalic trunk, was keeping the false lumen in all the brachiocephalic vessels and also into the descending aorta, causing brain ischemia. And this is the surgical prosthesis here. You see, this is the proximal ascending aorta surgical prosthesis. Many surgeons still, many surgeons, they fix only the primary entry, the proximal entry into the, of the dissection, and they rely on the nature, the centralization of the flow into the true lumen will resolve the rest. But unfortunately, in many cases, it's not true. So in this situation, you see, here is the dissection just before the brachiocephalic trunk. There is an extreme compression of the true lumen on the descending aorta and almost totally compressed true lumen on the level of the left and right carotid arteries. And this is the reconstruction of this gentleman. What to do? Of course, more than obvious, the redo surgery is risky around 1 year before he was operated. And there was a huge discussion what to do and what to perform. The debranching was also difficult because of the dissection persisting on both carotid arteries. So it's not easy to make a debranching with a distal anastomosis on already dissected vessels. So it was also problematic. The risk was considered too high. And because of that, we decided to make like a salvage procedure, so to put a stent graft into the brachiocephalic trunk from the right arm, to puncture directly the left carotid on a retrograde manner in order to put a stent graft, second stent graft, into the left common carotid. So this is the puncture of the left common carotid that was closed by the proglide, and this is the moment of crossing into the true lumen of the carotid artery and going down into the ascending aorta. And in fact, to meet all the three tubes, let's say, all the three tubes to met into the ascending aorta within the surgical graft. So we were using the surgical graft as a landing zone. So this is the situation. One chimney into the brachiocephalic trunk, second chimney into the left carotid artery, and the valiant aortic stent graft coming into the aortic arch in order to make the three parallel parallel tubes, covered tubes. And this is the implantation parallel to the grafts. You see the tips, the distal tips of the two schnorkels, of the two chimneys. And this is the final result. You see the flow restoration into the true lumen. And there is no Faust lumen. You probably remember how big was the Faust lumen at this level. And it not anymore seen. So there is no any more Faust lumen and excellent flow into the brachiocephalic vessels. And this is the final result. The second case is 69-year-old male after resection of the ascending aorta a long time ago in 2012. Because of the persisting dissection, he had two secondary interventions, one with a valiant captiva into descending aorta, but because of the continuing dissection into the abdominal segment, he received a multi-layer flow modulation implantation into the distal thoracic and the abdominal aorta. Unfortunately, still, the Faust lumen was persisting on the level of the aortic arch. The Faust lumen is huge. It's two times bigger than the true lumen, and there is an imminent rupture of this Faust lumen aneurysm on the level of the arch. Based on the previous case success, we decided to perform something similar. You see the valiant captiva thoracic aortic stent graft, and this is again direct puncture of the left carotid, access from the brachiocephalic from the right subclavian artery in order to put the chimney. This is a stent graft going into the brachiocephalic vessel, and this is the implantation of the chimney. Again, these are the two chimney grafts, and here is the opening of the arch graft. This is the balloon inflation of the chimneys, and this is the balloon inflation, probably next one, is the triple kissing. So inflating the two chimneys into the carotids and inflating also molding. In fact, it's not a real inflation, it's a molding of the stent graft in order to have, like mentioned, in order to have good sealing on the proximal level. And in this case, it was mandatory to close the subclavian. You saw probably, I will go back in order you to see better, that from the Steele syndrome is supplying not only the subclavian artery, but also it was supplying the Faust aneurysm. Could you please play the left cartoon? Left, not right. Click on play on the left. Yeah, play. And in case the guys can succeed to play the left cartoon, you are going to see by the subclavian artery that the Faust lumen is filled. So in this situation, could you try again? Go one slide back and try again. And in this situation, we have to close the left subclavian artery. It's mandatory to close because otherwise we are going to create a dead space under tension and it will rupture. So because of that, we put a vascular plug into the ostium of the left subclavian artery, and we succeeded to close everything. So this is the closure with a ProGlide, the closure of the carotid puncture. Fortunately, the Bentley stent graft is 6 French compatible, so it's excellent to implant the ProGlide. And it's you see, excellent flow in both brachiocephalic vessels without filling of the Faust lumen. So it's a good centralization of the flow. This is the third case. It's even more dramatic. It's a lady, 68-year-old, who was admitted in another hospital with everything dissected. Not only the aorta, this is the aortic valve, you see, proximal dissection, too proximal to think about endovascular intervention, it's not possible. So proximal dissection just above the aortic valve, and the dissection, spiral dissection into the brachiocephalic vessels, and it's like a multiple entry tiers and multiple flaps. So you can observe flap into the brachiocephalic vessels, into the descending aorta, and extremely compressed. You see, it's like a needle. The true lumen is like a needle, almost totally occluded. So we decided to reverse the intervention. So first, to restore with stents the flow into the true lumen vessels, both brachiocephalic, visceral, renal, and aorta. And on a second stage, to make the surgical intervention, because the lady had a malperfusion syndrome, mesenteric, visceral, and renal kidney and brain, malperfusion syndrome. So she was, it's true, she was more or less inoperable. And from the other hospital that she was admitted, they canceled from surgery. They left her on natural evolution. So this is the intervention into the mesenteric artery that was almost totally closed. So we restored the vessel, the mesenteric artery. We stented, you see, there is no flow into the brachiocephalic trunk and into the carotid because of the compression of the true lumen, real malperfusion. And because of that, we implanted stent into the left carotid, into the brachiocephalic trunk, into the left subclavian, into the mesenteric vessel. You see the protege, several proteges into the brachiocephalic trunk, into, you see, the stents that are restoring the flow into the true lumen in all the three brachiocephalic vessels, and also the carotid. Here is into the brachiocephalic trunk and the carotid. And this is the implantation into the subclavian artery. So after doing that, you probably remember there was no flow into the right carotid artery. Now it's excellent flow into the true lumen. And she restored. She started speaking. She felt very well. And definitely, and this is the implantation of a stent in the suboclusive aorta. You see? It's really suboclusive aorta into the true lumen. And the lady was operated several hours after that with this surgical operation with very good result and with restoration of the flow into the vessels. So as a conclusion, despite off-label, endovascular options are still here. They are emerging as viable option in treatment of complex cases of aortic dissection type A and aortic arch saccular aneurysm. And we have probably in the future, of course, bigger series and higher experience in order to prove the role of such intervention. Thank you very, very much for your attention.
Congratulations. It's amazing and not always easy to understand what is going where. But the result is at the end marvelous. And I just wanted to ask you about this patient. Most of the time, we see some residual flap after operation for aortic dissection type A. So when you decide to go for the endovascular procedure, you are waiting for something to develop like a symptom, or you have Absolutely. Something in the imaging which showing you that you may be doing Absolutely. It preventive?
To be fair, we have in our follow-up several patients with residual false lumen persistence. The most important is to take a look at the ischemia symptoms and ischemia signs on the imaging and to measure, to make a serial CTAs in order to take a look what is the evolution of the false lumen and the true lumen and what is the, in fact, the ratio between false and true lumen. In fact, in case the true lumen becomes two times smaller, so just the opposite, in case the false lumen becomes two times bigger compared to the true lumen, it's impending rupture. So we have to follow very strictly every 6 months such kind of patients and to decide based on the clinical. You see, the patients that I'm showing are severely symptomatic. Severely, it's not possible to wait. But in case we have a really severe enlargement of the trulumen, despite good hypertension control, probably in this case we have some elective indication to do something. And in our experience, in collaboration with our cardiac and vascular surgeons, we have several patients with total debranching. Even 2 weeks ago, we had a patient with total debranching of the brachiocephalic vessels. And after that, it's easy to put a stent graft into the arch. And for us as well, what I'm showing, it's not the first one choice. The choice first one is probably really total debranching, and after that put in a stent graft. This is probably the best way up on nowadays.
Okay. The other questions?
No, I'm very impressed. Very good done cases. Yes, I must say, because it's very critical. The normal, it's much easier where you have the dissection starting at the left subclavian. Yes. Then you can go in and place, you can sacrifice the left subclavian when the vertebral on the right is good. Yes, but here, that are very critical, life-threatening cases, yes?
Yeah, it's true.
Okay.
In case you are...